The comprehensive annual financial report, it's in our Dropbox, but this is.
Well, go ahead and call this meeting to order. Be it resolved that the Board of Supervisors hereby enters into a closed meeting for the purposes of discussing the following. Discussion or consideration of the acquisition of real property for a public purpose or the disposition of publicly held real property where discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the bargaining position or negotiating strategy of the public body. 1, State Street. 2, former Blacksburg High School property. In addition, discussion or consideration or interviews of prospective candidates for employment, assignment, appointment, promotion, performance, demotion, salaries, disciplinary, or resignations of specific offices, appointees, or employees of any public body. 1, Community Corrections and Pretrial Services. 2, Parks and Recreation Commission. 3, Planning Commission. 4, Social Services. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. Moss?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Echo?
Aye.
Sounds
good.
Thank you. Is there a motion to come out of the closed meeting?
No.
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Certification of the closed meeting. Whereas the Board of Supervisors of Montgomery County has convened a closed meeting on this date pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas Section 2.2.3711 of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by the Board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Supervisors of Montgomery County, Virginia, hereby certifies to the best of each member's knowledge that only public business matters lawfully exempted from an open meeting requirements by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which this certification resolution applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion conveying the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered by the Board. And this certification is the Board's word that we're only talking about things in closed session that we're supposed to be talking about. Is there a motion in regards to the certification?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Brooks?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Next, our agenda is a moment of silence. After that, I would ask the County Administrator to lead us in the pledge.
Let us pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much.
Next is presentations, recognitions, and awards on our agenda. The first up is the comprehensive annual financial report for the fiscal year that ended in June 2016. Mr. Aldridge, would you please come forward?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you all for having me tonight. As you know, each year I have to come before you and present the audit results, and you should have a packet in front of you that's actually the comprehensive annual financial report. I understand it's also in your Dropbox as well. So if you have that document, I'm just going to touch on a few high-level things. And if you do have questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Or if you need me to come back, I'm happy to go in depth later on. But in that document, you know, each year as part of the audit, we have to look at the county, the school board, the Economic Development Authority, and the Public Service Authority. So all that information is bound up in this document as far as the financial information. And we issue an opinion on this audit, and it's on page 1, and it says Independent Auditor's Report. And down at the bottom of that page, under the opinion section, it says, in our opinion, the financial statements referred to above present fairly in all material respects. So what this is known as is an unmodified or a clean opinion. That's the highest level of assurance we'll put on a financial statement. So you have a clean opinion on your audit. Okay? If you were to go over a few pages to page number 7, you can see the balance sheet there for the governmental funds, Exhibit 3. Just want to point out a few things to you here. You'll notice, if you look on page 7 there, the general fund would be your first one there going from left to right. Just want to point out your fund balance, okay? The way this works, you have assets, you've got some cash, receivables, those type of things. Then you've got your accounts payable, any amounts due to other entities. And then you're left over with what's known as fund balance, okay? And it's in various categories. You've got non-spendable, you've got restricted. Restricted would be an outside entity restricting what you can do with your fund balance. You've got committed, where you as a board have committed those funds. You've got assigned, where management has assigned those for projects. And then you're left with what's known as unassigned fund balance. So that's the fund balance that's not tied to any project or anything in particular. That's the one, as far as you want to measure or see how we're doing, you want to track that from year to year. And one of the things we often do is I'll take that number and compare it to your expenditures, okay? Your expenditures this past year are about $111 million, approximately, okay? You take that number, divide it by 12, and come up with a monthly average, okay? Once you have that monthly average number, then you divide the unassigned by that, okay? What you come up with, if you go through that exercise, you have 2.3 months of fund balance, okay, of unassigned fund balance, okay? If you were to go to the Government Finance Officers Association, that's kind of a think tank for government accounting, they will tell you you should have at least 2 months. That's kind of the line in the sand they go with, and y'all are sitting at 2.3 months, okay? So again, if you look at that, you compare to what the industry averages are, you're ahead of that. That number for last year was 2.3 as well. So you've been consistent 2 years in a row on your fund balance. Okay. Going through, I'll skip the notes. There's a lot of good information in there. I encourage you to look at those. But I just want to point out a couple other things to you, I think, that you might find of interest. On page number 80, you can see there the information for the school board, and that's broken down into two particular funds. You've got the operating fund, and you have the cafeteria fund. And again, that the fund balance there, the unassigned fund balance and operations of schools is $1.4 million. And you can see the cafeteria doesn't have any, what you would call unassigned. All that money is for the cafeteria, for that entity itself. All right. Something else I want to point out to you, I think it's critical to look at. It's also great when you're thinking about your upcoming budget. If you look on page number 90, this is back in what you call statistical information. There's some good stuff in here. It shows you the last 10 years, what's going on at the county. And one of the things that ought to jump out at you is if look in the revenue section there, okay? Back in 2007, our total revenues were $84 million. This past year, our total revenues were $119 million. Here's the key thing to look at. Look at that very last line, intergovernmental. That's revenue from the state and the feds, okay? Look at that. Back in 2007, $18.8 million. 10 years later, $18.5 million. So that's why it's important for you to realize we've got to continue a good, strong tax base because we're not going to get the money from the state. Okay, that hasn't changed in 10 years. In fact, it's gone down. So it's just something to always think about where the money's coming from. And as you're budgeting, just realize that money from the federal government, the state's just not increasing like everything else is. Also in this document at the very back on page 108, not only do we look at the numbers, we have to test a certain amount of federal money that comes through the county, and this would include the schools, would include social services, and we have to pick certain programs from year to year. And you will see on page 108 the programs we looked at this past year. You can see the school breakfast program, school lunch, Social Services Block Grant, Title I grants to local education agencies. Those are the programs we looked at. And I'm pleased to tell you, in looking at those programs, there were no findings at all. Okay, so no items of non-compliance that I need to make you aware of. So again, clean opinion on the audit, and also no findings on the federal dollars that came through. In addition to that, there were no findings related to the state code. You know, we have to look at certain things, such as, you know, you're aware of those disclosure statements y'all have to file. We have to look at those and make sure you're doing that, that type of thing. We didn't have any findings that needed to be reported as well there in this document. So with that, that's a pretty high-level view, but I'm happy to answer any questions y'all might have.
Supervisor Shepherd, do you have any questions?
I don't.
Supervisor DeMont?
I don't at this time, but I think it's important to commend our staff and those in the finance and accounting departments on a very, very, very good job. It is through the efforts of many people and through your firm as well. So thank you very much for this report, and thank you guys very much for all the work you do.
Supervisor Biggs?
I'll just echo what Ms. DeMott said. Same thing. Thank you, and thanks, staff.
Supervisor.
No, I don't have no question, but I would like to say the county taxpayers is lucky to have this group of people work for the county. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Supervisor Perkins.
Same thing.
Supervisor.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Supervisor Creed.
Thanks for going to all that to get LMP.
We can stay longer if you want.
I too want to thank our staff. When you get this type of clean bill, this is what we want to see, and I'm very thankful that our staff has done this type of job. Thank you as well.
Thank you, John. Appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
I just want to say, any other recommendations?
Next is on our agenda, the Montgomery County Health Insurance. And
this is Tom Mackey.
Tom McKay.
McKay. Tom McKay?
Now, aren't you glad I didn't bring up all that mad stuff?
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Tom McKay, and good to see some of you. I know some new faces. It's been almost 4 years before I was in front of this board talking about changing your health insurance plan from a fully insured plan to a self-insured plan. So the purpose here today is really to give you an update on the decisions you made and really show you that it's been a sound strategy on those decisions you made, and really give you some updates on what else has been going on for the last 3 or 4 years in the health insurance world, particularly to the Montgomery County plan. And really, it's a bunch of good news, because usually when I sit in front of boards or decision makers at organizations, when we talk about health insurance, it's rarely good news, to be honest with you, as you can tell from the struggles that our whole country is having when it comes to healthcare. So good news that I'm going to share with you today on some of your decisions, and I'll give you an overview and take questions if that sounds okay. Okay, so again, my name is Tom McKay. I'm with Marshall McClellan Agency. Back 4 years ago, my firm was a different name. It was KSPH. We since have merged with another organization just because everything going on in healthcare, trying to keep up and make sure we have the resources to support our clients. So as, let me see where I push the buttons here. So we're ready, looking here. So the first page is the agenda. So what we're going to cover is that the self-insurance was the initial strategy that we went through with you almost 4 years ago. We'll go over that. We also went through basically a strategy to help the county and the schools leverage your buying together and go out to market to leverage your larger size to get a better deal. And we'll go through that strategy and how that's helped. And then the last is prescription drugs. We always hear about the price of prescription drugs. So we actually did an RFP on prescription drug coverage on a standalone basis, carved out from your medical program, with some nice results that we'll share with you also. And at the end, we'll show you your claims experience. Of course, health insurance the major cost component of any health insurance plan, whether it's fully insured or self-insured, is the claims that your member are generating. And because of the self-insured strategy, that is the majority of the cost of the program. So you're taking the risk, but you also bear the fruits if you do have favorable claims experience, which has been happening the last few years. So overview, again, you've been providing a health insurance plan for a long time, and as a fiduciary, you have to balance providing the best possible benefits for your members and your employees with the fiduciary responsibility of making sure you're shepherding your dollars for your tax base. So as I said, 4 years ago, we started out with the strategy of going from fully insured to self-insured. That took place on 7 July of 2013. With that, we also changed your plan year from a July basis to October basis, and the whole reason for that was so that we would have the ability to go out to the marketplace and leverage the school's population and the county population in one RFP, which took place the next year, 10/14. And then this past October, summer for an October effective day, we went out again as the schools and county combined to leverage your volume for a prescription drug RFP. And we'll show you the results of that as we go through. So one thing again, as I said, we typically, there's been a lot of pain in health insurance, the rising costs is a fact, and organizations have struggled. And what a lot of organizations have done to deal with that is they've made changes in their plans. And when they make changes in their plans, they typically implemented higher deductibles, higher co-pays, higher cost sharing, shifting some of the costs from the plan to the employees. And what's really an amazing stat here is that the county has not made any cost shifting for the last 6 years when you look at plan design and employee contribution. So your employees are fortunate to be on that end. That is not the norm that we see in the marketplace from other county government schools or other private employers. And because of the self-insured plan that you implemented, you'll be able to keep your funding rates, which is basically your premium rates, at the same level for the last 3 years, which again is a remarkable statistic because we see normal medical inflation running at that 8 to 10 to 11% over the last 5 years, basically. So one of the things about, as I said, self-insurance is we had recommended that 4 years ago. It's a lower cost plan because of administrative fees and taxes are a little bit lower, but the risk is you could pay more if your claims are higher under the plan, because the majority of the cost is still your claims. And if you think about it, any program you set up, your claims are going to be your claims, right? Because someone is going to go to the doctor or going to be in a hospital, whether the plan is self-insured or fully insured, they're still going to have claims. So really, the plan goes in and it's how do you mitigate that and how do you plan for that over the long term? Because as I said, typically, groups at Montgomery County side are going to see volatility in claims. You're going to have some large claims that are going to hit, and you're going to have years that it's been favorable. So the last 3 years have been favorable, but you have to plan for the years where it's not going to be favorable. And I can tell you, it's going to happen. It hasn't happened yet, knock on wood, but it will happen for a group of around 400 employees, because you're going to have some things that are unlucky. People have some large claims, and it's going to impact the plan. So one of the things to do is when you have years of favorable experience, I'm going to show you've had, is to keep that reserve and use that to offset years when you have claims that are above what are expected. So for example, we put in this slide here, if you were to have a year where your claims were 15% above what was expected, that would be a $600,000 shortfall to the plan that the county would have to cover, to give you an idea. So luckily, you haven't had that in the first 3 years. So again, as we go into these strategies, the first was self-insurance, and when we were back talking to the board 4 years ago, you were looking at coming out of the NRV, Newer Valley Consortium, and you were looking at a 22% increase in health insurance premiums on a fully insured basis. So we went out to the marketplace and did some analysis, and basically we were able to cut that increase from 26% down to 12%. With a self-insured plan and funding the plan based on expected claim levels going forward. And that was without a change in benefits. That was the same benefits that you had under your plan. As I said, we also put in a 15-month plan year that first year so that you could, next year, go out with schools and bid on a joint basis together to get there. So what has happened in the last 3 years? Again, very, very favorable results. First year ended up in a $509,000 surplus. So after you budgeted at 12% rather than 26%, at the end of the year, you still had a surplus of $509,000 because claims did not materialize where it was expected of. And I'll show you the claim levels in a few minutes. Next year, another good year, $576,000 surplus. And then this past year, the best year so far, $773,000 surplus. So again, your claim level from your members have been performing at favorable levels. And this way, instead of being fully insured, paying the premiums to the insurance carrier, and they keep it, it stayed in your fund as a surplus of assets. So in 10-14, bid was made to go out to the marketplace with the schools on a joint basis. However, the schools and counties still maintain separate benefit programs, so the plan designs and your contributions are still independent decisions that you made. And again, the schools also went self-insured. That was a change for them going from fully insured to self-insured. So that happened at 10-14. What happened is you were able to lower what we call your fixed costs on the plan, the lower admin costs and lower stop-loss costs. So in the event you have a large claim, you are protected by stop-loss, so you're not totally self-insured. And with the volume of the schools, which is basically three quarters, they're about 75% of the total lives, and the county's about 25%. With that volume, you're able to leverage more competitive administrative fees and stop-loss fees to run the plan, even lower cost and hence more surplus. So again, no, there were no changes made, and we put in a risk-sharing arrangement so that it benefited both the county and schools. So stop-loss, individual stop-loss insurance is still the insurance part of the plan, so you're not totally naked. And you are purchasing at $125,000, so now we purchase in the marketplace at $250,000, so we lower the premium that you pay out to the carriers, but you're pooling with the schools on amounts over $75,000. So those large, unpredictable claims that you don't know are going to happen, you are combined with the schools, and you're basically pooling on a prorated basis. So more protection for both organizations at $75,000, yet you're not paying out the premiums to the market. So the last strategy was just this past October that we went out to bid for prescription drug services. So now, again, one of the benefits of being under one contract with the schools is you're self-insured, so you can carve out prescription drug and go out separate from your medical TPA, which happens to be Anthem. And also because of your size, you're able to do that. If you were only on the county with 400 employees, you wouldn't have the interest that you would from what we call the pharmacy benefit managers. So basically, we were able to go out to bid, and there were six pharmacy benefit managers that quoted on the business, including Anthem. At the end of the day, we were able to leverage the competitiveness of the proposal so that Anthem was awarded the business. And it was, as you see, 24% savings versus the past year, which on the county prescription drug piece meant $167,000 savings that we expect in this calendar year. Your plan year, October to September. The other thing is we have performance guarantees in the contract. So if Anthem doesn't perform according to the contract terms, they will write a check for the difference for any shortfall at the end of the year. And we will be auditing for those contract terms at the end of the year. Questions on that? Obviously, prescription drug, a lot of news. We've seen significant increase in the cost, particularly what is called specialty drug costs, which are really driving significant big prices because there's no alternative. People have some serious conditions, and these drugs do wonderful things, but there's sometimes costs, like the HIV drugs, that cost between $80,000 and $100,000. I'm sorry, the hepatitis C drugs, what I meant, that come to the market. So they're very expensive, but they cure hepatitis C. This gives you a picture of why we've been generating a surplus over the last 3 years. If you look at this graph, you see the year you came out of the New River Valley Consortium, the claims were running at $598 per employee per month for the plan year. And you see the next 3 years, you ran 522, 567, and 573. So that's remarkable that over 3 years, where I said trend rates have been at 8 to 11%, you're still not back to where that year was in 2012. Now, again, you have to be ready for a year like 2012. 2012, when it happened, you can see the volatility right here, 598 down to 522. And that's one of the issues we have with medical claims. You just don't know what they're going to be year to year. But, you know, you have over $2.5 million in reserves right now, so you can offset a year when you have that spike. And that's from the plan that's gone into it. And then I won't go through all this, but you have the numbers just to show you year by year, just a further breakdown that if you see the end of the number is 85, 79, 77. So basically, if you ran at 100%, you would have no surplus. So you were running below the expected levels where you funded, and that's what generates the surplus. Now, you could go up to 125% and you would have to fund that. But again, you do have some reserves sitting there to do that. So, in summary, the last 3 years you've run very well. Congratulations for that. As I said, health insurance is still very volatile, and of course we don't know what's going to happen on the federal level. We're going to expect a lot of changes over the next year as new administration comes in. We haven't seen the plans on that. Already yesterday there was some legislation that was, or I wouldn't say legislation, but an executive order signed by the president that was saying they're not going to enforce a lot of provisions of the ACA. So I don't think that means from an employer standpoint that you have to, it's going to change the cost provisions at this point, but it may ease some of the complexity of the reporting and the regulations that employers will have to probably go through over the next couple of years. But again, it's not legislation yet, it remains to be seen how that goes. I think the other question that really is in play there is what happens to the public exchanges, which really doesn't affect the employer plans here, that affects the individual market and how folks are buying their insurance. So, any other questions? Yes, sir.
I was just going to go around and see if our board members have any questions for you. Supervisor Creed, do you have any questions at this time? Supervisor Perkins?
No.
Supervisor
well King?
Me. Supervisor Biggs?
No, thank you.
Supervisor DeMott?
I don't. Thank you for coming tonight.
Supervisor Shepherd?
No, sir. Thank you.
I'd just like to thank you. I was, and this board decided 7-0 to become self-insured. You look at the savings over the last 4 years, but also this board, 7-0 hasn't touched that $2.5 million that's been put away in the reserve. I think that says a lot about the fiscal conservative nature of this board, and also our staff has not recommended that we touch that in any way, shape, or form. So I'd just like to give credit where credit's due, both the staff and this board and yourself, and thank you very much for coming this evening.
Thank you.
Tom, thank you for all your help. Tom's done a great job. When we have questions and concerns, we reach out on the phone and have conversations, and you know, we've been very blessed, but that can change in 1 year. That's why we need to protect those reserves.
Right.
Again, thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Is there a motion to go into work session?
Motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam, any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
7-0.
We're in regards to work session, a FY 2018 budget review estimates. Come tell us a lot of great news.
Good news. She's not smiling.
She's not. What now? She is smiling now. I was worried.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Good evening. My name is Mark Brewer. I'm the county's budget manager. And tonight I'm going to give you a rundown on our preliminary revenue projections, some highlights from the state budget. Give you a little background information before we get started. As we've talked about in the past, county revenue falls into two categories, undesignated revenue and designated revenue. The difference is how your ability to utilize those funds. Undesignated revenues are unrestricted revenues, which means that they can be used for just about any purpose. Designated revenues, on the other hand, are restricted revenues, meaning that they're earmarked for a specific purpose and can only be used for that purpose. When we look at the revenue categories, the undesignated revenue piece, the piece that you have the most control over makes the lion's share of the revenue. It accounts for about 89% of the county's revenue. And three categories, as a general rule, make up the lion's share of the growth that we receive on a yearly basis, and those are real estate, personal property, and sales and use tax. Now, earlier tonight, you heard the presentation on our audit, and it was interesting that the auditor brought up the fact that over the last decade, the amount of state revenue that we received in 2007 is exactly the same amount of state revenue we're receiving today. And what has happened is, back in 2008, you know, we had about an 80-20 split. 80% of our revenue was undesignated, 20% came from the state. But as the state has basically not given us any more money, and as our growth has continued to go, we've seen that shift to an 89% amount that is required on the local side, and 11% that's coming basically from the state. So as you're starting to see, state revenue reductions are having an impact, and we have not, even as the economy has improved, the state hasn't come back and provided any more money to make up for those shortfalls over those years. The next slide gives you sort of a big picture of our revenue growth going into fiscal year 18. We're estimating $2.9 million in revenue growth for the next fiscal year. You see a breakdown by category. You see real estate's about $1 million. Personal property, again, almost $1 million. Other current property is around $400,000. Delinquent taxes is about $100,000. Sales tax around $400,000. And then all other categories of undesignated revenue are $200,000. So you get around $2.9 million going into the next year. So how does this compare to our normal trends? Our current growth patterns are very similar to prior years. Normal growth in undesignated revenue is in the $2 to $3 million range. Again, we're showing 2.9 going into fiscal year 18. Based on December collections, our 2017 revenues are trending very well to our estimates. And then one thing I want to talk about is, in fiscal year 2017, we included $1 million for the proration of personal property. I'm happy to report that it appears as though, based on our collections, we will meet that $1 million in new revenues in our estimate, and we will also have an additional $100,000 if everything pans out. So, again, another good news for the evening. The next slide gives you a breakdown of all the individual revenue categories by their individual area. What I'd like to point out is those big picture items. If you look at real estate, you're up there close to $1 million at $886,000. Again, personal property, the big ticket is in motor vehicles at $850,000. And then you can see the increases by individual category. Again, on this slide, you see the major increases in sales tax. And at the end, you see $2.9 million. At this point, I actually want to go back to the previous slide and talk about something that is an interesting trend in the current year. If we go back a year ago, one of the things that I brought to your attention was that we had to reduce the amount that we were collecting in delinquent taxes. In fact, when we went to finalize the budget in April, I came back and we reduced the revenue estimate. And the reason for that, if you look on this chart here, under delinquent properties and under the fiscal year 16 actual, you'll see $1.7 million. The estimate that I had included in the proposed budget was $2.1 million. And as I was seeing revenues coming in for the year, I noticed we weren't gonna get only 1.7 or something in the current year. So when I went to estimate that number, I'm like, wait a minute, we need to back that off. And as you can see in the 17 estimate, I dropped that back to $1.9 million. What's going on in the current year is, all of a sudden, we're on track to pick up $2.4 million in delinquent revenues, okay? Now, at the end of this year, you're gonna go, what are you talking about? How did you not see that coming? Well, I'll tell you, one thing that's going on with that is, there's two things that are really going on with that. The size of the delinquent tax pot is starting to grow. And the way you attack that tax amount has an impact on how much we collect. So I went down and talked to our treasurer a little bit to find out what's going on here. What I think is going on, and I think it's going to be a one-year blip, is the fact that when we switched over to proration, we had, in essence, a time period in which we were making all of these collections more current. So as we were, again, before we went to proration, we were a year, year and a half behind on our revenue. Now we're making it current. So we're getting all of these delinquent revenues that are coming in this first year. And so I don't think that trend is going to continue. I think we're going to get this 2.4, or what appears to be 2.4 coming in the current year. But I think going into the next year, you're going to get all that money on the front end, and then we're going to go back to our normal trend. So at the end of this year, if I come back and we're at $2.4 million, I sort of expect that. But I don't think that that's something that's going to continue going out into the next year. And the worst thing that we could do is say, hey, we're going to get $2.4 million, and then we have another bad year like fiscal year 16 and we only collect, you know, 1.8, and now you got a $600,000 hole. So I just want to keep that in mind and point that out so that when we get there, you know, say in August, when we're talking about what we actually collected in the current year, we can kind of go back on that. Okay, so let's go into the governor's budget highlights. According to the school system, the state is going to provide about $1.2 million in new revenue going into the next year. About $500,000 of that is tied to a one-time bonus for SOQ positions. And so they're going to have about $700,000 available for ongoing operational support. For the county side, the 18 budget includes compression pay for our deputies and a 1.5% bonus for constitutional officers. What I'd like to point out here is that because the county provides such a large supplement on our existing staff, all of that money is just considered revenue. And because the state eliminated the raise in the current year and made some other adjustments, there's really no new revenue coming in for fiscal year 18. So even though they included extra money in the current year, because of the actions that they took in fiscal year 17, we're not going to really realize any additional revenue there. Let's talk about our next steps. We're currently analyzing our budget requests. On February 13th, the schools will be here to present the proposed budget. On March 6th, the county will come back with the proposed county budget. On March 20th, we'll need to establish an advertised tax rate. And on April 6th, we'll have a public hearing on the tax rate and the budget. And then hopefully, if everything goes to plan, we should be able to adopt the budget on April 17th. At that point, I will say that I will be glad to entertain any questions you might have.
Can't remember which side to start, so I'll start Supervisor Shepherd.
I don't think I have any at this time.
Okay. Supervisor DeMont?
I'm going to agree with Daryl. This is one of those things that you kind of need to digest for a little while, so I will call one of you guys if I do have any questions. Thanks so much for being here and giving us this report. Much appreciated, and it offers quite a bit of clarity. I appreciate that.
Supervisor Biggs?
I don't have any questions at this time. Thank you for the information. I know we'll hear more about this next week in Richmond when we go up to lobby government day. So,
Supervisor King?
No, I don't have no question, but maybe you can go with Mary and them get us some state money.
Supervisor Perkins?
I don't really have any questions for this, but I would like to say that the school board will be having a meeting tomorrow night in which they're going to be discussing their budget. And they are somewhat behind on having enough money to do the things, of course, that they want to do. So, and that is due part to the state as well as everything else. And their budget, as considering the state funds, it's very bleak. But they questioned us about whether or not county funds were included in that. And obviously, they have not been included in that school board budget last week. But what will take place tomorrow night, I don't know. He went over primarily just the state money. That's all he went over.
Yeah, and I think that the last thing that I saw from the schools was where they are in their process right now. They're about 5.7, was that the number?
Yes, something like that.
About 5 million short.
Yes.
And that's assuming the same level of funding from the county that they received this year. So.
Right, they did not include any real county money in that.
That's correct.
They just said that's where it'll be. So I'm not sure what they'll come up with tomorrow night, but they will be talking specifically about it. And then they will come when? Next?
They'll be coming on February 13th, our first meeting in February.
February.
Yes, ma'am.
To us.
Supervisor Crew.
Just want to say thank you for all you're doing, trying to get this thing out to us as soon as you can.
I know your office doesn't deal exactly directly with proration, but it seems to be working well, smoothly.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've talked a lot with the Commissioner of Revenue and things that they've done is, you know, things are working fairly well, and the revenues are tracking very close to the estimates that we brought in. I was very pleased, you know. I mean, you go into this process, especially with something brand new, and you don't really know what's going to happen because, you know, we've not done it before. So, you know, to be able to be that close in the first year is a very good thing. It's going to be interesting because, again, we don't have but 1 year's worth of information in order to try and project what's going to happen in the out years. But, you know, part of this, and that's one other thing I want to say, you know, these numbers are going to change. You know, as we continue to refine them throughout the budget process, we're going to try and, you know, eke out as much revenue as we can get. One thing about the state, you know, they apparently projected way more revenue than they were actually going to receive. And that's actually a pretty bad thing because, you know, once you do that, you create a hole, and then you have to figure out a way to backfill that hole. And so, you know, we've been very fortunate in the fact that we've not created such a situation for ourselves. And so, given the choice, I'd rather be on the other side of the equation, not on that side where I have a giant hole that we have to sort of backfill.
Mr. Chair, I would like to commend Mark and also the staff in the Commissioner's office because they worked very hard once this board gave the direction to move forward with proration, and Mark provided a lot of guidance to them, and I think the reason the estimates are as close as they are is because of the dedication and hard work you guys did to make sure they were correct, and thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there a motion to come out of work session?
Motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepard?
Aye.
Ms. DeMoss?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Next up on our agenda is public hearings. There was one of the public hearings that was slated for this evening that has been withdrawn, and that would be the boundary line adjustment agreement with the town of Blacksburg, Harding Road, and that matter was withdrawn. And so the first item up on our public hearings is a special use permit by the NRV Regional Water Authority, a request by NRV Regional Water Authority for a special use permit on 2.0 acres in the agricultural district with possible conditions to allow the development of a public utility substation water pump station. Emily? I was looking down and then poof, you up here.
There she was.
I'm trying to keep us moving as fast as everybody else. I don't have any fantastic news other than clean water is very good.
Very good.
Yes.
Our first hearing tonight is, as Chairman Tuck said, a fairly straightforward application for a water pump station in the Price's Fork area. This vicinity map here shows you where the approximate location is right off of Price's Fork Road. This area lets you see the lot itself is wooded, and this home sort of sits down in a little knoll there. It's like a brick ranch style, and that gives you a little bit of a way to place yourself. This shows what the comp plan map, future land use map, shows for this area. And this is the existing zoning, so it's surrounded by A1. The site plan that was provided in your information is shown here. This shows you that even though the lot was fairly long and rectangular, we're only planning to use a portion of that. And you'll notice when we get to staff's recommendation that we recommend recognizing this as sort of a line for the SUP, and we'll talk about that. The other sheet provided in the site plan shows the additional landscaping buffer being shown. There is an elevation that the applicant has provided. This is approximately what the building will look like. This is a standing seam metal and then two tones of block. As we looked at the area, you can see the property is vacant. It's just a wooded parcel. And the request is to allow for a public utility substation, and that would be specifically a water lift station. 2-acre parcel, but approximately 1 acre is going to be a boundary line adjustment will be done to get that back to the larger portion surrounding this subject parcel. Just to give you a sense of what the property looks like, there is this little road here that sort of already exists. And if you look across, you can see that I think this is Wise right across from it. If you're looking down Price's Fork, gives you some visibility there. And then here's the piece of the house there that we were talking about. The impacts are very minimal on this project. This is part of a larger comprehensive project being undertaken by the Water Authority. They will get an entrance permit from VDOT. The VDOT representative's already been out there and talked to them about their site distance and what the entrance size needs to be like. They will be providing a transmission line. This is good for redundancy for water service in the area and into the town of Blacksburg. There's no school impacts, and the property doesn't present any environmental impacts. Some of the things that we looked at in the analysis was obviously one of the things we support is providing infrastructure to our citizens. The canopy is going to be retained at the site, and then they're providing some additional landscaping. The one building, which is made to look compatible with residential in the area there, and minimal trips to the site, so there won't be anyone stationed there, there won't be daily traffic, it'll just be as needed. Staff recommended approval of this application to the Planning Commission when we had our hearing last week. We did not have any members of the public speak at the hearing, but the Planning Commission did have several different questions and dug into it a little bit. We did have 2 recommended conditions. The first is that it to be developed consistent with both the site plan that we showed you as well as the elevations, so that consistency will be there. And our second condition was that it would only apply to the portion of what's shown as disturbed area on those site plans. The commission voted unanimously in support of this recommendation to the board, and that is all I have for you. I'm here if you have any questions for staff. Also, the applicant is here, both Gary Fern with WRA, who is the engineering firm, and Caleb Taylor with the Water Authority.
Thank you very much, Emily. Supervisor Creed, do you have any questions?
No.
Supervisor Perkins?
No.
Supervisor King?
No.
Supervisor Biggs?
No.
Supervisor DeMonts?
No.
Supervisor Shepard?
No.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and open up this public hearing. General public, thank you again, Emily. If there is, I don't believe that there was anyone signed up for this public hearing. However, you don't have to be signed up. Is there anyone who would like to address the board on this issue? Going once, going twice. We're going to go ahead and close the public hearing on this one. And the next is an ordinance amending Chapter 10 entitled Zoning of the Code of the Montgomery County, Virginia by amending Section 10-28-3 and 10-29-3 by allowing farm machinery sales and service as a by right use instead of special use permit in general business and community business zoning districts. And there you are again.
It will probably take me less time to do this presentation than to read all of that. And this is a fairly straightforward code amendment that was basically initiated by staff. We looked at the code and really felt like, as we'll talk about in the presentation, that this was a fairly simple and straightforward change. currently, as the legal ad described, we do allow farm machinery sales and service in our general business and community business districts, but by an SUP. And so the language that you have shows adding it to a by right use and removing it from SUP in both districts. Whenever we look at a change, one of the things we look at is the intent of the district. And we looked at both general business and community business and felt like this was consistent with the intent of both districts. We allow more intensive uses. And specifically for our community business district, it really is meant to serve the rural community. And so I can't think of a better service for the rural community than the farm machinery and sales that would keep them from being up and down the road. Another part of staff's analysis is to look at other similar uses. And I guess our biggest focus was on truck sales, service, and repairs. If we allow that, there's really, this is actually a less intensive scale, comparatively speaking. So another item we provided in the analysis was whether it was consistent with the comprehensive plan. Whenever we do a text amendment, we look at that. And our plan is very supportive of ag and forestry throughout the county because that's a big part of who we are. So staff presented basically the same thing to the commission. They agreed unanimously and provided that recommendation to the board. And that's all I have.
I'm going to just say, is there any questions among any supervisors in regards to this? All right, I'm going to open it up to the general public. Is there anyone? I don't believe there was anyone signed up to speak on this subject as well, but you don't have to be signed up. Is there anyone who would like to address the board as to this zoning ordinance amendment to allow farm machinery sales? And as the liaison with the planning, basically you can sell a dump truck, but you can't sell a tractor.
That's crazy.
Right now without getting a special use permit. And when Emily saw this, this is one of the things that she wanted to change. And as she said, that it passed without any problems. No further discussion. Item three, as I stated previously, that matter.
Need to close the public hearing.
Oh, need to close that public hearing. Thank you very much. Going once, going twice, closed. And then the boundary line adjustment was taken off the agenda. Is there any action that anyone wishes to take after the, since the public hearings have been closed?
I'd like to see if we can go ahead and put this back on the vote on.
Is there a motion at this point in time to, or is that on both issues or just one?
Both issues.
I'll second that.
There's a motion and a second. Can we take them up? Is it better to take them up separately?
Please. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so let's take the first one was, I believe, the NRB water. Yep. We can take that matter up first. So there's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion in regards to that matter? And so I take it that the motion is to go ahead and pass this?
Pass.
Yes. Yep.
All right. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Okay. Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
The next motion that I heard and seconded was in regards to the zoning ordinance amendment. Mm-hmm. Is there any discussion? And again, this is to pass that zoning ordinance. Wanted just to clarify for the record. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
All right, next item is public address, and there are several individuals who have signed up to speak. However, you don't have to sign up to speak. This is our board's turn to listen to what you have to say as citizens. It's not necessarily our turn to react to your statements. Typically, we do not respond, again, because many times you have to listen to us. This is the one time where we listen to you during these meetings. Actually, we listen to you a lot during the week, but during these meetings, this is when we're going to be listening to you. The first individual signed up is Douglas A. White. I would ask you to come forward. Please state your name and address, and you'll have 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Douglas White. My address is 760 Triangle Street. My address previously was 1548 Harding Road, Blacksburg, Virginia. I've given you some information tonight. Pictures speak louder than words sometimes. On the first page, there's an image of a pump house sitting in the bottom of a basin. That is the Windsor Hills Pump Station. The center picture is the well of that pump station, currently sandbagged. The bottom image is from Woods Court and the water runoff that contributes to the other side of the Windsor Hill Basin Valley. As you can tell, I'm a bit concerned about a pump station that's been neglected since 2008. And you can look at the last page, and you can see where Christian Trayball wrote a story about me, and the fact that I was requesting emails that were under the privy of Gmail, therefore not accessible to me back in 2008. So the good news is that I don't really request that way anymore. The bad news is the county's provided me no data thus far at all. I've asked for the boundary agreement, don't have it. Let me back up just a little bit more. 2008, when I entered this argument, the valley was a field. In 2009, it was still a field. In 2011, it was a field with construction activity around the pump house. In later 2011, it was a field with more construction around the pump house. In 2015, the field was replaced by a parking lot, and sandbags were added around the chain link fence of the well house. In 2015, when I returned to Blacksburg, having been away for 4 years, the parking lot is still there, and the sandbags have been moved around the wellhead specifically. As you see in your pictures, the wellhead is sandbagged. There's also a diesel generator and a fuel tank that's now sitting inside of the watershed because all the water goes right over the wellhead. The second page has detailed drawings of what the well actually looks like. It's about a 16-foot long vessel, 8 feet wide. It's got two-stage pumps in it that force sewage to the top of the hill at Harding Road, 140-foot worth of head on two pumps that were installed in 1970s. That's a 6 1/4 internal diameter, and that's a ductile iron pipe, so the inside surface is random, not smooth. It'll be very important when proving sewage capacity for pumping to the top of that hill. I'm really confused here. And the reason I'm confused is that the agenda item tonight was a boundary adjustment. And when we attended the meeting in Blacksburg sponsored by the builder, the town's attorney handed us a document, and it cited state code sections 15.2-3108. The interesting thing is that that's not where the section actually starts. It starts two sections before in 3106. And there's like letters and words that mean things. And the words mean, I should read from 3107, before adopting an agreement pursuant to each governing body shall advertise its intention to approve such an agreement at least 1 week or two successive weeks in a newspaper having general circulation. It also indicates that there should be some version of a boundary document, right? Some written text that indicates what the boundary document would be. We've been asking for this for the town. We've asked the county. Marty, I've been in your office about it. And there doesn't seem to be like a written document. It doesn't say anything in the code at all about a developer interloping inside of a government issue. And the government issue is the boundary adjustment between the town of Blacksburg and Montgomery County as a municipal government. It has nothing to do with the developer. So I ask, I beg, I plead 9 years later that you guys work through Ms. Perkins to get me the information that I'm asking for. And that's everything that has to do with the boundary adjustment between the town of Blacksburg and Montgomery County, and everything that I asked for about the Windsor Hills pump station. Because we learned this last week that there was a breach before 1990. Two wells were taken. I had that data back in 08, but it didn't mean anything. We also learned that the main pipe broke between the pump station and the top of the hill in March of 2015. There's a graph in your data there of the flow data from the wellhead, and it indicates 40 gallons per minute away from overtopping.
Thank you, sir. The next in person signed up is it Carol, and is it, I will maybe mispronounce your name, so I'll spell it, S-C-H-W-O-B-E-L?
Schwobel.
Ms. Schwobel, will you please come forward? And if you would state your name, you have 5 minutes.
Thank you for hearing my comments. My name is Carol Schwobel.
And your address, I forgot to add that part.
1416 Harding Road, Blacksburg, Virginia. I'm here to make comments about the boundary adjustment, which you are not hearing about, but you may hear about later. And I have three concerns. One is the traffic, increased traffic as a result of the proposed development. My property is smack across the road from this 27 acres, which the POF property, which since 2000 has been up and off and up and off for development by various developers. My concern for one is traffic. Over the last 12 and a half years that I've lived there, traffic has increased pretty significantly. As you know, it's a main thoroughfare into town. And on game day, football game day, it's pretty much nonstop because people come over from 81 through Catawba and through Oronto, and then they come up Harding Avenue. It's pretty much nonstop in front of my house. I'm concerned that a development of 99 units will pretty much produce more traffic that that road can really manage. There's no there's a road, but there's no shoulders. And quite a few times people have run off the road trying to avoid traffic encounters. My other concern is student housing. It's outside of town. The developers say that they're only providing less than one bathroom per bedroom, and they don't have a pool, and that's going to discourage students. And as most of you probably know, there's students all over town that share bathrooms and that don't have a pool, and they do just fine as students. My concern is that parents are going to buy the property and we'll have a lot of commotion across the road. My third concern, and it's the most important concern, is the water quality. And there's two aspects of that. First of all, 30 years ago when my house was built, I was told by the owners that they blasted the basement out of solid rock. There's an awful lot of rock over there. And I know that now they don't blast. They crack the rock somehow or other. And across the road, there's a lot of karst terrain. And my concern is that if they start moving rocks around to make room for the pipes and the gutters and the streets, that it's going to impact the clean water that all of us use as a result of having wells in the area. We all have wells. My other concern about the water is that I myself experienced a breach in my clean water. Apparently, in late September of 2015, we had an awful lot of rain coming out of the sky. It was more than 8 inches over a period of a week. And usually I get water in my basement when it's that much water. And yes, indeed, I did have water in my basement. And this was, I was told that in September of 29th of that year, there was an overflow in the Windsor Hills pump station. Now, at that time, I knew nothing about this, but I started getting sick. And I had any number of tests done. I finally, this was the 1st of October, I started having gastrointestinal symptoms. I ended up going to the doctor the 19th of that month, I finally said, this doesn't make any sense. I'm going to have my water tested. I had my water tested. Now, in April of that year, I had my water tested. The total coliform was absent. Then in October the 19th, in desperation, I had my water tested at Clearwater Creek, and it tested present for coliform. I was then, went on to have the well, oops, I had the well chlorinated. It tested absent again. I had it tested several times after that. It was absent.
Yeah. Your time is up. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
The next individual signed up is, and I'm going to have to spell this last one as well. It looks like Andrew, and I'm not sure if this is an S-C-B-E-N-K-E-R or S-U.
Andrew Schenker, 1025 Janelle Road, 1030 Janelle Road.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. I will be brief. Just wanted to tell you that for the last year, I've been trying to get a culvert, get VDOT to address a culvert at the end of my driveway in the right of way. I'll give you that.
Individual's card.
I don't really want to go into a lot of detail about my own particular case, except that it poses a certain public safety risk on the road, and VDOT moved Janelle Road in front of my house, and then they lost the paperwork for the project, so I'm kind of stuck. But another interesting thing that I discovered this last year was that VDOT has only approved 4 driveways on Janelle Road, and so other property owners will be responsible for repairing their driveways when they wash out, and that can be, you know, thousands of dollars depending on the situation. So I was thinking that the county might want to consider in when they list the houses and the square feet and all that on the websites, the taxes, and whether the access to the county road is approved or not by VDOT, so that, I don't know if I'm being clear, that when the next property owner comes along, they might be in for a big repair that they didn't anticipate. I will say that the individuals that I spoke with at VDOT are very kind and not at all helpful. Repeated self-imposed deadlines have passed with no word, no return phone calls, nothing. And they do a great job clearing the roads, but they don't want to help me. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. That is all the individuals who are signed up this evening. But again, just because you did not sign up doesn't mean that you can't address the board. Is there anyone else who would like to come forward to address the board? Okay, I see two. If both of you would just come forward, and whoever gets here first may speak, and then if the other one would just have a seat in the front row, that would be helpful.
Hi, my name is Gary Glessner. I live in 2800 Wright's Way, Blacksburg, Virginia. I just moved there about less than a year ago, actually, came from California. I've been hearing about this boundary adjustment issue that's at the POF property. A number of people have spoken about it today in the meeting. I just want to ask that it's taken very seriously. It there are a number of different things that can happen if this development goes through. The traffic is a big thing, but I think that the largest problem is the problems that we can have with the groundwater. Everybody's on wells down there. The water basically goes downhill from Blacksburg that way. And the pumping station that seems to be not, the quality of the station is not good enough for what it's used for at the moment. There's too many factors, I think, that we have to pay attention to. And I think that we can get any engineer or geologist to sign off on it for the development company. So I'd like to just make sure that we don't just allow this to just happen, and the boundary adjustment, because I think it doesn't seem like all sides are taking it as seriously as the residents there. So I just want to make sure that people are aware of this, and as I learn more and more about it and get more and more involved, I think we'll definitely find out more of the issues, and everybody can be more informed by it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I believe you came forward. If you would please state your name and address, and you have 5 minutes.
Howdy. My name is John DeLong. I live at 1520 Hardy Road. I'm also here to speak about this boundary adjustment on Hardy Road. I just bought my property about a year and a half ago, and I worked for Virginia Tech and came here to this area as an undergrad for tech and really fell in love with the rural area of it. And so that's why I bought my property on Harding, because it has a little rural feel, and it's an older house from the 40s. And Blacksburg is really growing and changing, and everything's getting bought up, and you know, they're almost trying to develop it like Northern Virginia. But I think there's some things that we as a county and people who live here need to protect. And I think building a huge complex on this property would take away from that feel we have here. And Blacksburg's from Blacksburg, and there's flatter and easier place to build than the Continental Divide, where we create this water problem. So we've heard everyone else speak, and I'm concerned about the water. I've had similar issues to as Carol with my stomach just in the year and a half I've been there, because I think my well is infected. When I bought the property, we had a chlorine shock it, and then this September I also had some stomach issues, and unlike Carol, I didn't do anything about it, because I'm young and busy. But then again, last night we had a nice flash-flooded event on Harding Road, and so we'll see how this next month goes. Maybe I'll get around to testing a lot. But yeah, just bringing you guys awareness of this, and try to keep Montgomery County as beautiful and everything we enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Gerardo Rivera, 1600 Winslow Drive, Blacksburg. I'm here to make a couple of points. First, about the Poth property. I have attended all the relevant public meetings, whether in the county or in the town. It seems that the process of boundary adjustment is not as clear as it should be. I think it would be best if our county and the towns come up with a unified and clear pathway to this process. I felt bad for the developer as well. Also, during the process, I came to know about the stormwater problems and possible sewage issues that should be examined by both the town of Blacksburg and the county, regardless of any development. There are indications that the channel below the Windsor Hills apartment complex is inadequate, and thus any development on the Puff property needs to be closely monitored. The problem at hand relates to the general discussions that I have had with our engineers about cross-boundary line stormwater problems. Of course, this is a bi-directional matter, and the party affected should be somehow compensated. Our residents living downstream should not pay the price for irresponsible development elsewhere. Second, I'd like to thank you very much for the letter you sent to VDOT for it to reconsider its decision to go ahead with the ARCOT plan, a plan that is not favored by you, Town of Blacksburg, Delegate Lowe's, Senator Edwards, and above all, our citizens. I'm pleased to announce that our online petition so far has generated 376 signatures, and the comments made by all citizens clearly show what their demands are. We are all concerned and fearful that another precious life perish at that intersection or elsewhere in the nearby streets as a result of the band-aid approach called the ARCOT plan. This is the time for VDOT to come to its senses, to abandon the ARCOT plan and the Commonwealth Transportation Board to fund the construction of the ultimate solution, a grade separated interchange. Our county and our town deserve better. It is not right for a major town in this part of our state with a major university to partially close one of its major arteries, and by doing so, to internalize the trouble and shift the problem elsewhere, in the town and the county. That threatens the lives of so many of our residents and the university students alike. We do not want to see any more parents mourn the loss of their loved ones, whom they sent here to study in a safe environment. Please continue your support for our fight for the ultimate and sensible solution, a grade separated interchange. Thank you.
Thank you. It appears that's all the folks I've seen coming forward. Is there anyone else that wants to address the Board of Supervisors? At this point in time, I'm going to go ahead and close the public address. There is an addendum.
Yes.
One, a resolution scheduling a public hearing by the Board of Supervisors with the intent to dispose of county-owned property. And the resolution reads as follows: be it resolved by the Board of Supervisors of Montgomery County, Virginia, that the Board hereby agrees to schedule a public hearing for February the 13th or soon thereafter, or at 7 p.m. or soon thereafter in the Board Chambers at the Montgomery County Government Center located on 755 Roanoke Street, Christiansburg, Virginia, in order to hear citizens' comments on the Board of Supervisors' intent to dispose of the following properties, namely, and real estate agreement to convey 0.287 acres to Shaw Development. The description of the property would be as follows: 0.287 acre portion of the Motor Mile Park situated on Tyler Road, Route 177, Montgomery County, Virginia, tax parcel 104-A-10, parcel ID number 070697. Again, this is only to schedule a public hearing in regards to that. And is there a motion in regards to the addendum?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion in regards to the addendum? All right, as to the addendum and adding it to the agenda, Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Ms. DeMotts?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
Now, Marty, do we need to then vote on all the resolution?
Yeah, we need to approve the resolution.
To again have a conduct a public hearing. This is not to actually convey the property. This is just to advertise a public hearing to get the citizens' input.
What did we just vote on?
We voted adding.
Okay, got it. So now we're voting to schedule it. Got it.
Actually, schedule it. We added to it. Added to the agenda. Is there a motion in regards to passing this resolution as I just read it?
Did you add it under new business?
We can add it under new business.
I think it was added under new business.
So it would be new. It would be item B, right? I mean, we'd add it.
You can do it now if you want.
Okay.
Since we're taking it up, is there a motion?
Motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. DeMott?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
Okay. Next item on the agenda, a resolution supporting House Bill number 17.
Yeah.
Oh, I did skip. Thank you very much for keeping me straight.
That's all right.
Is there a motion regarding consent agenda?
Motion.
Second.
Any discussion in regards to consent agenda? Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Mr. Shepherd?
Aye.
Ms. DeMott?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Chair Perkins?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
Chair Perkins, awful day. Right, I'm so glad to know that. All right.
Congratulations.
Stand up.
Next on our agenda is subject A, resolution supporting House Bill number 1741, naming the Virginia Route 114 bridge between Montgomery County and Pulaski Counties the Vietnam Veterans Memorial Bridge. Is there a motion?
Motion.
Second. Second.
Any discussion?
I just want to know, do we pay for the sign?
Yes.
Is it $500?
Approximately.
Yes.
Just want to make sure everybody knows we're paying for it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am. This is a discussion, so yes, ma'am.
Who brought this up?
I believe Delegate Rush contacted us to indicate whether we would support it or not and asked it to be added to our agenda.
So when we voted just now, we
haven't voted yet. It's just a motion and a second. We have not voted yet.
That's right. We just added it to...
No, what we added was the resolution to do a public hearing for the 0.2 acres in regards to the Motor Mile Park and transfer.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
This issue actually came about, I don't know if you recall, the county received a letter. It was actually when Chair Brown was still here, about naming a portion of a roadway in honor of the Vietnam veterans.
Okay.
And we referred them to the city of Radford because the particular road had impacts on the city as well. Did not hear anything back from them, but apparently in the discussions it came up that this particular bridge between Montgomery and Pulaski County could be designated as such. And Delegate Rush contacted our office to say that they were going to move forward with naming it, but that they needed a resolution of support from both counties in order to authorize that, and that because there was a misunderstanding a couple of years ago about a bridge naming, that he just wanted to make sure we understood the county would be asked to pay for the signage.
Right. Okay. I just wondered, and
In the resolution, it does indicate that he is the one who submitted the bill.
Okay.
House Bill 17.
Yes, sir.
The signage, is it on one or both ends?
I think Pulaski is going to have on one side, and then we'll be putting up the sign
on this side.
And Pulaski pays for their sign, and the Montgomery pays for
our sign.
Our sign.
Okay. That's
but the state is asking us to do it.
It's the way that bill is designed. It falls back on the localities. They get to designate it, but the way the bill is written, the localities have to pay for it.
Yeah. I think what happened was we went through this in naming something after a state trooper, and that's
Trooper
when
Fox.
That's when we found out that the General Assembly can ask you to name something, but then you have to pay for it. And somewhere along the line, I'm not sure when, that was pushed back to localities. They can ask you to name it, but then you have to pay for it.
I don't personally have any problem with installing signage or paying for it, but I do think that that's an interesting political conundrum, that the state can ask us to name something because they want it named that, and then they can tell us, here's your bill for doing it.
It prompted a lively discussion.
Yeah.
Yes. It was the bridge across New River.
Yeah. But And then at the same time, I would, and Mary touched on this, I think everyone touched on, our Vietnam veterans were not particularly honored or treated very well at all.
They weren't.
And $500 for a sign and to name them as
Oh, I don't think anyone's against
not at all.
Yeah, no. Because everyone wants to honor people that deserve to be honored, and certainly the Vietnam veterans deserve to be honored. But I'm just making the point that this is another situation where the state asks, they do something, but they push it down to your level. I think it's that, you know, a lot of times people that maybe listen out there hear our frustration, just like we did earlier with the budget, you know, that the state gives less and less money, but yet, you know, we're required to do more and more. So I just sort of, whenever I feel like I need to make that point, I bring it up, because I really feel strongly that we need to be lobbying our state people to get a little bit more money back to the localities. That's all. And you guys know, anytime I get a chance, I'm going to bring that up.
And I understand your position, but in my world, this gives us an opportunity to be a part of it.
Yeah. Sure.
And yes, the state could go ahead, but we had to pass this resolution, and this is I like being a part of it. Mm-hmm. So is there any other discussion in regards to
it? No, I wholeheartedly approve of recognizing the Vietnam veterans that way.
That being said, no other discussion. I know that April doesn't have any place to go, not like a plane to catch here in a few hours. I'll go ahead and ask the clerk to call the roll.
Mr. Shepherd?
Absolutely, yes.
Mr. Motz?
Aye.
Ms. Biggs?
Aye.
Mr. King?
Aye.
Ms. Perkins?
Aye.
Mr. Creed?
Aye.
Chair Tuck?
Aye.
Seven
ayes. Next up, County Attorney's Report.
Just a quick rebuttal to the word on what Mr. White said. Twice I've met with him in my office concerning this boundary adjustment process and try to explain to him how it worked. But anyway, I remember once asking for a copy of the agreement. However, the agreement is part of the agenda tonight because of the public hearing, and I've since, he made these comments tonight, I since forwarded him a link to the agreement, so he has a copy. So I just wanted to clarify that. I mean, he's never asked me for a copy, even though I've talked to him probably for an hour total, hour and a half. Yeah.
Can I ask one question? That sewage treatment.
That's not anything to do with the county.
That's the town of Blacksburg's. That's not the PSA. It has nothing to do with the county. No. We have no control over that.
We have no utilities in the area.
No.
Okay. I knew that, the answer to that. I just wanted for the public's knowledge that's not our...
Well, that's why we were looking at a boundary adjustment. Because
we can't provide utilities. That's correct.
Everybody backed off right now.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, the developer, everybody asked us to take it off our agenda, and we did. So... Thank you, Marty, for clarifying. County Administrator's Report.
The county attorney used all my time this evening, so I don't have a report.
Oh, goodness.
That being said, Supervisor Perkins.
I have no report other than I did attend the school board meeting. It was not a very long one. They did have reports from employee groups. I think if I say this now, then I don't have to put it on the email. But
yes, you did. Very bad.
Too bad.
Email.
Too bad. No, I would have if I hadn't been in bed this entire week with vertigo. I would have had it on there. But your eyes don't function very well when you do have that, and you don't move very well. So, but anyway, they did have each of the employee groups speak before the board. They did talk a little bit about the budget, and our county administrator told you that they were about a little over $5 million behind of what they had anticipated or what they really wanted, and that they would have a meeting tomorrow night to discuss more of the budget in order to be ready to present to us on the next meeting we have, which would be February 13th. And so that's basically where we were for the most of the meeting. And then they did discuss, as you saw in the newspaper, that they would ask a student, a junior or a senior, from one of the high schools to be a part of the board, but there were some restrictions placed on that, that they would not be voting, they would not be allowed in closed meetings or anything like that, but they would be allowed to participate from the point of view that what they had to say about what the board was doing, and that they wanted it for information. And many school systems are doing it, and many, sometimes boards of supervisors do it. I don't know where, but I have heard of it in the past. So I think that that is the major things that were discussed, and they will finalize the budget and make recommendations to us on the 13th of February.
Thank you. Supervisor King.
I got two things. Me and Supervisor Cree went to Shawfield Rescue for their installation officers a couple of Saturdays ago. And John, he was telling us that they had 55,000 hours of training and running calls just in that one station. Now, I mean, that's big news. Training and running calls out of one station, 55,000 hours.
Wow.
But the big news is Gary Creed was installed as an honorary member of the Shawfield Rescue Squad.
Congratulations,
Gary.
And they said how much they appreciate everything he'd done for that area. And Gary has done a lot.
Yes, he has. We all have.
And number two, at the Dixie, got an email, I think, Craig, did you get the one about the DMV and the information that they go down to help the inmates that's getting ready to transfer out of the jail, and they give them ID cards and everything?
Yes, from the regional jail, yes.
Yeah, regional jail.
Yes.
On the January 11th, they transitioned 69 with IDs and everything. It brings to 222 the most ID cards in any jail in Virginia. Bobby Russell and his group down there is doing a wonderful job. They really are. I want to tell them here out in public how much I appreciate what they do. I mean, they're dedicated to make sure that people that's incarcerated there, when they get out, that they are ready to face the future in public.
Yes, sir.
And I appreciate that.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Supervisor Biggs.
Yeah, I do have a few things, actually. I attended a couple meetings last Wednesday, and one of them was the New River Mount Rogers Workforce Investment Area Consortium Board in Withville, meets quarterly. And one of the things, they're going to be sending their annual agreement that, you know, needs to be signed to each of the localities. But one of the things that was brought up is that you can have an alternate to that. The way that was set up, it's supposed to be the chair of the board, and then if the chair of the board can't come, I guess it's the county administrator, but they go with elected officials. So I just wanted to alert you that we need to officially appoint an alternate to it. So I don't know, you know, how you might want to work that, but I got the impression it either needs to be Craig or an elected official from our board. So that's first thing. So maybe we'll put that on the agenda for next time.
Okay.
All right, then the next, the executive director, Marty Holliday, did say that, and I know we're getting into budget time, so this wouldn't be a good time, but sometime if the board would like to have her come and talk about what goes on there, she would be more than happy to do so. All right, then the library board of trustees, Wednesday night last week, interviews are going, will be conducted for Paula's, Austin's job. You know, she's retiring, so the executive committee is on that, and I think next month they'll be conducting interviews. So that's sort of an update on that. Then on Thursday, on the Animal Care and Adoption Center, we were able to have a meeting and take a tour, and it looks like right now that the opening date as far as public will be more in the springtime, late spring. So I just wanted to update you. They're waiting on getting some equipment in there and also shelving and that kind of thing, but it looks really good. It's really, really coming along well. when we were over there, the dogs in the old shelter saw us and they were all barking, and all I could think is they want to come over here. They were all barking at us, and they were, you know, so I'm excited about that. And then that evening, that Thursday evening, I was able to go to meet with a group of fifth grade boys that are in Scouts in PAC 152, and they were studying about making the country better. And I want to give a shout out to two of the county employees that helped me along the way with getting information for these young people, and that would be Bill Long with some excellent recycling information, and then Mitchell Hawk with all the Parks and Rec. And so I made packets for each of the Scouts, and I put all the county information in there. And we talked a little bit about, you know, what it means to be on the Board of Supervisors, and I encouraged them to really think about running for public office or getting involved in their community. They're doing a lot of community service projects, and I really had a good time that night. It was sort of interesting to get back into my teacher mode, and some of the kids had actually been in the last third grade class I taught, so it was interesting to see how much they had grown up. And then last but not least, those of you know, I serve on the MBC Development Corporation, and I just want to report that's the Montgomery County Blacksburg Christiansburg Development Corporation. It is this group of people that meets, and we look at loans that people like small businesses might need a little bit of help with. And I just want to report that everything is going well with that group, and that we have some money that we can loan out. And I guess that's it. Sorry it took so long, but that's all the meetings that were going on last week.
Well, I think Supervisor.
Yeah, NACO Government Day. Can't wait to go to Richmond. And
Supervisor King, I believe that's
how far are they behind on this animal shelter? I thought it was supposed to open in January.
Well, I thought it was supposed to open in December, and then January, then February, and now we're more into March and April.
Well, I hope they...
Well, I think that Mr. Meadows has been cracking the whip over there behind the scenes, and so has Steve, right? Mm-hmm. Would you like to elaborate on why it's running a little late?
Is there something in a contract penalizing this company?
There can be. I mean, there's liquidated damages in a lot of contracts, but you have to prove damages. Well, we currently have a place that we're operating. The instructions that staff have given the contractor is, as I've shared with y'all before, it's much better to get it right than it is to get it done. So they had a few things that slowed them down a little bit, but as Supervisor Biggs said, it's really coming along nicely. It's actually allowed, because it's been a little slow, it's actually allowed for staff to get some things developed rather than having to move into the facility and get things developed while they're trying to get the offices up. So there's been a little bit of benefit to it too, but yes, it is behind.
I mean, it might be me, but if you got a date, you got a date.
We do. And we've discussed that with the contractor. Yes, we have.
Well, I hope we think twice before we get the same one again.
Any other comments?
So I guess Craig will keep cracking the whip.
We're going to do what we can do.
I think that whip will become a riding crop.
We've got a lot of experience with construction projects, so we'll work through it. Yes, we will.
Supervisor DeMonts, I expect this to be a very, very long report.
No report.
Supervisor Shepherd.
Oh, I got a bunch.
Oh, God.
No report.
Supervisor Creed.
Just one thing, and I had two or three, but I just wanted to talk about one. The trash truck down in my end of this Montgomery County is, anybody know what the deal is on that? Well, I've had both lately that says that Roanoke has done and figured out that they really need that, and they're going to.
The train and the negotiations with the... I know that the Resource Authority in Roanoke has been acquiring property, but I also know they're still negotiating with Norfolk Southern. So I don't know that any decisions have been made whether they're moving forward with that or not.
I've got some citizens that would like to know, because they don't want nobody coming down there and taking this new road or something away from them that's already laying out there that they have spent, some of them 100 years trying to get a road to come in there that is halfway decent.
The next opportunity I have to talk to the Roanoke County Administrator, I'll ask. We talked about that back several months before the holidays, but I haven't gotten an update on that recently either.
And I know that Roanoke reached out. They were wanting to have, I went down there and met with some of the folks from Roanoke, and I know they've reached out and said that they were willing to come up here. And I'll make sure to bring that subject up and report back to you.
People need to know.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're going to worry yourself to death if you think something's going to bother you and then you just stand there and shake yourself off. It doesn't work too good.
Thank you. As you know, I have a short report, April. I serve on the Fire and Rescue Commission, and they were getting the final numbers in. Right at 12,000 responses that our volunteers, both fire and rescue, have responded to. That works out to about 33 a day that folks from all over the county are responding to. Watching them again this year work through their budget process, hearing them negotiate and say, well, you know, I can put off getting a truck, or I can put off getting this piece of equipment to make sure that they come within their budgets. And listening to these folks who are giving their time back to our community is awe-inspiring. I'm glad to hear that you're an honorary member, and I sit here with Todd, who volunteers, and his wife volunteers as well. He volunteers with the Reiner Fire Department. His wife volunteers the Reiner Rescue. And I greatly appreciate those folks. But again, 12,000 calls, 33 a day on average. So with that being said, there's no other business that I'm aware of. And April can make her flight to Mexico. Take care. This meeting is adjourned.